Good afternoon. We have the happy task of talking about hate online, something that many of us have experienced, but few of us have experienced with the intensity as media people, and we have two on our panel today to help us understand that. To my far right is Yair Rosenberg of Tablet. Yair is senior writer at Tablet, where he covers the intersection of politics, culture, and religion. His work on these and other subjects has appeared in many other publications, including The Wall Street Journal, The Guardian, The Atlantic, and The Jewish Review of Books. Welcome, Yair. Yair is a substitute for Steve Cole, Dean of the Graduate School of Journalism at Columbia University, who took ill today, and thank you for pitching in.
Thank you.
Yair's left is Jonathan Weisman, deputy editor in the Washington Bureau of the New York Times. He's been on the campaign trail for many publications, and as we were saying backstage, has done the grand slam of journalism. He's worked at the Washington Post, USA Today, the Wall Street Journal, and now the New York Times. Quality rises to the surface. Jonathan, welcome.
Thank you.
And to Jonathan's left is Brittan Heller, who's the first director of technology and society for the ADL, a hire that was made just a few months ago, in part because of topics we're talking about today. Brittan has an extraordinary background, which includes work for the Department of Justice prosecuting hate cases. She's a graduate of Stanford and Yale Law, was a Truman National Security Fellow in 2005, has been a public interest lawyer, has worked abroad in the Peace Corps, and has an extraordinary background. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I thought we'd dive right in and start right off with some of the experiences that people on this panel have had. Notably, Jonathan has been singled out in many ways by the Twitter community for his high-profile work in the New York Times. And the best way to get our arms around that is to have Jonathan tell his story.
Well, I like a lot of you, probably almost all of you, I had never heard of the alt-right until I ran into it myself. During the campaign, it was towards the end of the primary season, a columnist named Robert Kagan, he's at the Brookings Institution, wrote a column for the Washington Post about the rise of fascism in the United States. And I tweeted it out on my Twitter account using just a quote from Robert Kagan's column. I can't even remember what the quote is. I mean, this is something that I do all the time. If I see a story or an article that I like or I find interesting, I'll tweet it out using some kind of catchy piece of it to just catch a reader's attention. I got something back from, I think, Emperor King Trump that just had my name, Weisman, in these three parentheses, brackets. And you know, it's funny, I knew, I had an intuitive sense that this was some kind of anti-Semitic thing that I had never seen before. And I tweeted back at him and I said, do you care to explain? And he said, oh ho, I've belled the cat, you Ashkenazi, whatever, something bad. And from that point, he had indeed belled the cat. And then there was an absolute deluge of anti-Semitic hate just thrown at me. I mean, and when I talk about hate, I'm talking about, you know, my face superimposed on corpses in Auschwitz, a gate, the famous gate into Auschwitz transposed into Mockin' America Great Again, pictures of my head being cut off by an ISIS guy. I mean, it went on and on and on. It never, it kept going. And at first I was so startled by it that I would just say, wow. You know, I'd kind of tweet it back out and say, look what's out there. And of course, by tweeting it out like that, it would just, wow, you know, that guy's got like 30,000 followers. I've got 5. I'm gonna send him something even worse. And it just snowballed. And I actually did understand that that I was making a decision that could be second-guessed. I mean, for about 24 hours, I just started sending all of these anti-Semitic tweets back out into the ether under my account so everybody could see what was happening. And I think a lot of people were really taken aback. I was taken aback. I didn't really know any of this was out there. I mean, you know, when I grew up, I wasn't a particularly religious Jew as a kid, and I always used to joke that my Sunday school education was mostly Holocaust education. And you know, you learn about eliminationist anti-Semitism but you kind of learned about it as history. And suddenly, every stereotype, line of attack that you ever read about or heard about in Sunday school was coming at you. And this was my introduction. I eventually wrote a piece for the Times Sunday Review about this experience. And then I wrote a second piece about leaving Twitter. I am back on Twitter. It's a little hard not to be on Twitter when the president of the president-elect of the United States is communicating with my newspaper that way. But it kind of quieted down to I'd get maybe two or three of these really, really nasty tweets a day. But that was it. And then Twitter really did lower the boom a couple of days ago. It was really something to behold. But that's my experience.
And just for context, some of you may have read the ADL study of this very matter. And both Yair and Jonathan are lucky enough to be in the top 10 most anti-Semitically targeted Twitter people around in the journalism community. And just so you know the scale of this, in the ADL study, they found 19,253 overtly anti-Semitic tweets sent to at least 800 journalists. And although we differ in scale, even me, an academic, I had such an experience. I was on Fox News a few weeks ago, and I am obscure, and my last name is Brown, and I received a few of these tweets, as hateful as they can be. And I'd urge all of you, after our panel, or if you know journalists, just to look at these tweets, because even the few I got, nothing compared to what Jonathan got. When I share them with friends and show them to them socially, or I'm a teacher and I've showed them to students, it's an eye-opening experience, even for someone without the profile of Jonathan and Yair like me. Yair, your story?
Thank you very much. And thank you to ADL for having me and for holding this conference. So on that study that the ADL did that you mentioned, I'm proud to say that I ranked number two of the most abused Jewish journalists on Twitter during this election season. And I wear it as a badge of pride. And it's actually something I think about a lot because I've been dealing with this stuff because I have a very, very Jewish name. When you see Yair Rosenberg, you might as well be named Jewy McJewface. And so it's like when I write something that you disagree with, it's a very easy thing to do to go after me because I'm Jewish. And so I've been getting this sort of stuff from people who would later become known as the alt-right for years. Before the campaign, these parentheses I'd seen before, you know, Trump became a serious candidate, there were all these sorts of tactics that these people were sort of building in order to harass Jews online. Trump became their rallying point. He became a cause. He invigorated them. He made them more enthused. And then people started noticing when these trolls went after mainstream journalists. But they've been there for a long time, which means that when they hit me in full force for the election, I already had ideas and strategies of how to deal with them. And because the discussions of anti-Semitism today are very often very dark and depressing, or in any form of bigotry, it's like, here's this thing, and it's really bad, and let's talk really more about how bad it is, and how bad it has been, and how bad it's going to get. And I like to also talk about things that you can do about it. And Brittan's going to talk about that in the context of corporate responsibility, in the context of companies and policymakers, and also individuals, but I'm going to focus on what people can do if this is the sort of thing that you want to do. So when I encounter, you know, an anti-Semite photoshopping me into a concentration camp or a gas chamber or using an anti-Jewish slur, an anti-Jewish stereotype against me, I have particular responses. Most of the time, I'll just ignore it. They want attention. It's not worth it. But sometimes it's worth highlighting so that people can see it. I have a lot of followers on Twitter, many from all walks of life, you know, Jews, Christians, Muslims, atheists, and many of them may not have encountered or realized that anti-Semitism is a real force today. And by highlighting it, I'm able to make them aware of it. But it's challenging because talking about bigotry is a difficult conversation because it can be dark, it can be depressing, and people don't really want that in their social media timelines and in their ecosystems because it dampens your day. And so if I just see a racist thing and I say, oh my God, that's so racist, I'm really angry, and something to this effect, it will be shared on social media by people who already agree with me and are already just as angry as I am about that thing. But it won't really reach people for whom this isn't already a reality and for whom this isn't already an issue. So I tried to figure out a way, how can I make people actually want to share anti-Semitism on Twitter, which is a difficult challenge. But I'll give you an example from today. So just this morning, actually late last night, I get a tweet from somebody saying, you know, Trump has won, the Jewish media, we're going to shut it down, and you'll be the first to be ovened Jew, right? And then they have a picture of like an anti-Semitic Jewish caricature. And so if you look at my Twitter feed now, and say you're bored with hearing me here, you can look me up on your phone, and you will discover, not that anyone would ever do such a thing, but if you look and see what I did there, I, you know, excerpted the tweet, and I said to them, I don't mean to be a grammar Nazi or anything, but ovened is not a real verb, right? And then this got retweeted a lot of times, and the person got ridiculed a lot of times. And surprise, if you go look at this, the guy is still there. Twitter has not gotten rid of his account. I don't know how long that will last. But he deleted that tweet because he was tired of getting all of the mockery that was coming his way for his failed attempt to rile me up. And one of the things to understand, so this is what's going on here. What you need to understand is what these trolls do. Some of them actually believe these things that they tweet at you about Jews, but a lot of them are nihilists. A lot of them are just nasty internet users who know that they can unnerve Jews, they can make them afraid, they can make them scared, and they can make them withdraw from the discourse, say go off Twitter, or be afraid to write about certain subjects if they abuse them enough. But they don't actually believe these things, and what they're trying to do is turn this sort of trolling dynamic on you and make you uncomfortable. So if you refuse to take the bait and turn it around on them, right, they don't know what to do, and in fact, they don't like it when it's turned on them, and they will often delete their own original provocation. Another example, someone tweeted at me, why are Jews so weak and bad at sports? Now, does this guy actually believe it? I doubt it. He just thought it would get me angry. But what it actually was a fastball down the middle. And so I just excerpted his tweet and said, well, of course Jews don't really participate in athletics. That's what we use to divert the energy of the Gentiles while we take over the systems of power. So, as you can see, I just have, you know, and the more you do this to me, the more you tweet this sort of abuse at me, the more you're giving me ammunition, because what happens there is that lots of people found that funny, just like you, and they clicked retweet really quickly, because it wasn't dark, it wasn't depressing. But what they actually did was get deputized and turned into informal educators about anti-Semitism without realizing it. Which brings us to the infamous parentheses, which is these triple parentheses that anti-Semites were using, white supremacists were using on Twitter, to identify Jewish journalists, to call other people to troll them, and in general, just to unnerve Jews, say, like, you tweet something we don't like, instead of engaging with your argument, we'll just say Rosenberg in parentheses to try to make you afraid. And I thought this was kind of silly, and so did Jeffrey Goldberg of The Atlantic, who put three parentheses around his name, and I thought, this is a good idea, I did the same thing. And then I tweeted, this would be fun if other people did it. So I said, if you want to show solidarity with Jews who are being harassed and mess with Twitter's Nazis, just put three parentheses around their name and it'll become entirely useless because everyone will have them. And then I logged off for Shabbat, and I don't use Twitter on Shabbat, and I highly recommend, even if you don't keep Shabbat, good plan. So I log off for Shabbat. I come back after Shabbat, and like thousands of people have these parentheses around them. I have Muslim followers, a Muslim follower of mine named Fahim, who writes back and says, you know, he's got three parentheses around his name, Fahim, and he's like, oh man, I'm Muslim, this is going to really confuse them. Yeah. And it's a way, and so that's like step one, because we took this tool of harassment away from them. Now no one can use it, and today, no one gets harassed with this particular tool anymore because it's entirely useless. But it did something else, which is after this took off, I wrote an explainer piece for Tablet where I work, saying what this symbol meant and how we've subverted it. So in case you're seeing it, this is what it means. And then I track when people share my own stuff on social media to see where it's going, what people are saying about it. And a lot of other people wrote a very similar piece in much bigger, more prominent websites, at Vox, at Slate, at the New York Times did a piece. But I followed my particular explainer, and I saw lots of people tweeting it because people were asking them, why do you have parentheses around your name? And people I've never met and never heard of and we've never interacted, even on Twitter, are saying, well, here's an article that explains it. And I'm only seeing mine, but there are, remember, dozens of these, so there are probably many more such interactions happening. Which means all these people who put these parentheses about their name, again, became educators on anti-Semitism. And that's my goal. My goal is to find ways to empower people to fight back, and empower people to educate, and not feel like it's a dark and depressing endeavor, but actually that you can do it and you can do it with joy. It doesn't work for everyone, and some people this can be very emotionally difficult, and if it is, you shouldn't do it. And I advise you to disengage. But for a lot of people, it can be very empowering. I talked to a retreat this past weekend of Muslim leaders who are dealing with similar stuff as Jews are right now. And all of this stuff similarly applies to them, and like conspiracies about Sharia law. And they felt it was very helpful to them because all the time they're being told that, like, you know, batten down the hatches, and they're told that they need to, like, deal with these things in a political way, and it's true. But there are also ways to show solidarity online in the systems that we inhabit today. And I think that that's really important for all of us, regardless of what companies and policymakers do. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Yair has laid out his personal response to all that. Brittan, your task, among many others, is to think through the institutional response to all this. And what's the status of your work with Twitter and in the internet community, the digital community?
Thank you. I wanted to take one moment first to explain why I personally care about this as well. 10 years ago, I was actually the Jane Doe plaintiff in a highly publicized cyber harassment suit. So when I came into ADL, I was already aware of this issue and interested in it on both a personal and a professional level. Like you both, I was told first to just ignore it, and I ignored all of the harassment until it got to the point where it crossed over into real-life consequences. And I think that's the point we're at now. The reason we did the first report, which was really unique because it was a quantitative analysis, not just reporting all the bad things that people said on Twitter, but really looking at who was doing the harassment, what the scope of it was, where it was coming from, and how many people it reached. My favorite, if you can have a favorite, I think one of the statistics that came out of this study that really speaks to me is that the reach of the anti-Semitic language was equivalent to a $20 million Super Bowl ad. So I think it says a lot about the normalization of this kind of speech. So taking those results and translating them into action items was the next part of ADL's project. And I think a few of you have this at your seat, but this came out today. It is Control-Alt-Delete, recommendations of the ADL task force on the online harassment of journalists. And what we've done is we've broken it down into three different areas: recommendations for industry, recommendations for journalists, advocates, and targets, and recommendations for law enforcement and policymakers. We're gonna have a speaker following from Twitter who's going to explain about the actions that they've taken very recently to really track this head on. But ADL, I guess to encapsulate it, we think that social platforms need better reporting options. They need to improve the response time about these complaints. They need to invest in new tools to curb cyber harassment. They need to work on transparency about their abuse process reviews. That's the nutshell. For industry, I think it boils down to two main things: context and re-victimization. When people are harassed online, oftentimes, and when we did I'm gonna rewind for a second. To gather the recommendations for this report, we consulted with our task force, which was composed of top journalists, academics, and people affected by this issue. I individually consulted with over 150 outside experts from law enforcement, journalists, academics, advocates, lawyers, and tech people. And so that's how we distilled what the problem was and the solutions that we could derive from it. So if you look at the report, we have over 25 specific recommendations that can be implemented by these groups. So if you look at industry, a lot of it focuses on context. When people are harassed, they complain that they cannot explain the context, because if you're being harassed in 140 characters, it's really hard to explain why you feel intimidated or threatened. So we're recommending that the tech companies allow for further explanation and also train the people who are supposed to be evaluating these complaints. Oftentimes, they come from different contexts than the people who are being harassed, and so to understand that, you need to provide some means of explanation. Kind of going with this is that we also recommend more transparency in these complaint and review processes. Because most of the time, when people would complain, they'd say, we don't know what the hell is going on. Sometimes we get our complaint accepted, sometimes we get it rejected, but we're complaining about the same things. So transparency in how these processes work would help people engage with it. I also think that focusing on re-victimization is an important aspect of this, because when people are being deluged with thousands of messages every day. And they're just one person. You have to understand the burden that it puts on somebody to have to try to find each one of these, report them all individually, and track the spread of these messages. So we've recommended that there be more efficiency when people have to make multiple complaints, and to not have to have people relive this painful experience again and again and again when they're trying to mitigate the harms. For journalists and targets and advocates, there were three things that we looked at specifically. And if you look at the report, we actually did a portrait of the most interesting things coming out of the tech industry in the last 2 months. And so this is not a comprehensive portrait, but it's really highlighting people who are doing interesting things that haven't been tried before. One is using positive counter speech, which, like you said, is beating trolls at their own game. Some of these groups are using more speech to educate. Some of them are gathering positive counter mobs, where when they see someone being harassed, they will unleash a wave of aggressive love towards that person. And it works. It drowns out the hate speech. We profiled new tools for journalists. There's one suite called the Coral Project that's being put out by Mozilla that's going to allow journalists to have more control over how they present their information, how the comments section works, and it's from individual bloggers all the way up to major platforms. And then recommending that people apply smart cybersecurity measures. For lawmakers and policymakers, we'd like to make sure that state laws are modernized that actually reflect the way that people are abused online. Just applying state analogs for stalking or for other types of violent crime to cyber laws doesn't translate. We'd like more funding for law enforcement and training, because if you're harassed, what they tell you is, oh, go to the police. You have to go to the police. That's the first thing. And the response that most people get is, turn off your computer, which does not address the problem, especially when the harms translate into real life consequences. So we want to make sure that the state and local officers who are this first line of defense have the resources and training that they need to take this seriously. Part of this is criminalizing new forms like swatting and doxing. Doxing is when somebody takes your personal information, like your phone number and your address and your social security number, and they put it online with a call to action for people to harass you. It's quite damaging for the target of that. Additionally, there's swatting, where somebody pretends to be you. They will spoof your phone number, and they will call and say that there is a murder going on at your house right now, and the SWAT team needs to be there right away. So law enforcement and the SWAT team, guns blazing, shows up at your house. Again, the potential for serious consequences. And I think the final recommendation from ADL is that we invest in innovative research. And this is for the tech industry and for the entrepreneurs and really for all of us to try to engage. We would like to promote something that we call anti-harassment by design. This is in the same vein as privacy by design or cybersecurity by design, where we want people who are developing platforms to think about solutions proactively before there's a problem. It is much easier to build protections and think about these concerns when you're making something rather than adding it on at the end. And I think with that's a nice capsule summary, but if you look in your app, you can actually see the text of the full reports, and it should be available online. Thank you.
Thanks, Brittan. I'd like to make sure we try to put this into context. Have either of you experienced this kind of feedback, shall we say, in periods before the current presidential campaign? And is this brand new to the world we live in, both because of the power of Twitter and because of the freedom people apparently feel to share their emotions?
I mean, Yair talked about that he had a experience way back. I actually did not. I mean, I've been a reporter for major newspapers for a very long time, and every once in a while you'd go down to the mailroom and you'd get that crazy screed in your mailbox, sometimes from a schizophrenic, sometimes from not. But I mean, really,
these are in crayon usually, right?
Usually in crayon, exactly,
right.
Or cut out letters. But nothing like this, because Well, they didn't have the platform. And as I said, I mean, Yair, I don't know, he's had this experience, but to me, it was very, very new. And I also, to put it in the context, look, I do not want to think that being attacked on Twitter is like, you know, the Hispanic kid being harangued at school or the Muslim being beaten up in the street. And it was one of the reasons why, you know, I wouldn't go to the police or things. I always kind of downplayed it. I mean, certainly people have had much worse experiences than me. In fact, my colleague Maggie Haberman came home a few weeks ago, or I guess last week, to find a huge sheaf of anti-Semitic writings in her mailbox.
In her physical mailbox. Home, which I believe to be in Brooklyn.
Yes, which is a lot scarier, frankly, than getting a note on Twitter. So let's also keep that in perspective.
Yair, what's your context, and how do you view this in the bigger picture?
Yeah, so I think the reason why I experienced this before the election in particular, it's A, my very Jewish name, but B, I write for a Jewish publication. I write on very Jew-related topics, whether it's Israel, religion, and I have somewhat liberal politics. And so all of those things really bother a lot of these trolls. And so I would get it before. It was not nearly as loud. The way I explain it to people is I don't think this stuff is new. I think that both the medium of social media and the election in terms of a rallying point in Donald Trump allowed these people to become much louder and made them feel much more empowered, to feel like history was on their side. This shouldn't surprise us in the sense that we've seen recently social media has enabled a lot of people to tell stories they couldn't tell. So for example, victims of sexual assault in the wake of the release of that tape of Donald Trump on Access Hollywood. So victims of sexual assault came forth on social media and told their stories. And they were able to find each other in ways they couldn't before. And we see this again and again. Social media was one of the primary movers in organizing the Black Lives Matter movement. And so it enables people who might have thought isolated or thought there wasn't somebody there who cared about these same things to discover, despite geographic distances, that we actually are all here together and should create positive change. But guess what? The racists can also do it, right? And the Nazis can also do it. And that's important to understand because it's like all technologies, they're only as good as the people who use them. And so the important thing is to train better people, right? And then because you can't put the genie back in the box, and that's why the counter-trolling is, for me, is a very serious thing, which is saying, this stuff isn't going away. We just have to use it better than the bad people and train other people to use it in a more constructive way.
The elephant in every room that we're in these days, whether it's a classroom in my life or when you're covering a story, is the election and the president-elect and the consequences of the change in power that's going on right now. How do you two view your expectations about this phenomena in the context of the elephant in the room?
You want to go first?
Sure. I used to get asked this question before the election a lot. What do you think this anti-Semitism stuff that's coming out online and somewhat filtering into real life means in the aftermath of the election? And I used to say, well, I'm pretty sure Donald Trump is going to lose, and all of these people who feel like they are empowered and history is on their side will realize, no, they were wrong, right? And this was their last gasp. And they may still be having their last gasp, but their last gasp is going to include 4 years with the person that they see as their avatar in the White House.
Things didn't work out that way.
Exactly. So I think we're going to see more of it, and I think that these people are going to feel like they're winning. I think they're wrong. I think, in fact, many people who voted for Donald Trump want nothing to do with this stuff, whatever you think of other reasons they had. So history is not on the side of these trolls, but they feel like it is, which is why you're starting to see more packets in journalists' offices and more reports of harassment of all sorts of minorities. Because these people feel empowered to act out on these impulses. I think it's important to notice, and because people say Twitter, it's true. Twitter's not nearly as bad as something happening in real life. And I would have told you that before the election, but watching the election happen, I would get people saying, well, you know, how many shekels did they pay you to say that, write that criticism of Trump, right? And I would just mock them and say, well, I don't get paid in shekels. The international Jewish conspiracy plays in chocolate, right? So like, that's my default response. But the truth is, if you go online now and look for videos, reporters were harassed at Trump rallies by people saying, you all sold out for a bunch of shekels. It migrated to real life. I have friends who are reporters who went to different places, and they got hit in real life with the sort of stuff that I was seeing only on Twitter. And so to believe that it just stays on Twitter, I don't think is something that we can really sustain in the wake of this election season, which means if you see it on Twitter, you probably should worry a little bit more about it. Don't freak out, but recognize that this stuff can migrate if we don't have a good response to it.
I think that's true. I mean, I You know, I think we all probably saw the video of the guy who was shouting "USA" at the, one of the last last Trump rallies. He later then told the Arizona Republic that he wasn't meaning Jew as in Jewish. He was just trying to have a Hispanic accent. But yeah, he was in solidarity with the Hispanics of Arizona.
Deeply reassured.
I do think that there is a real sense of empowerment. I mean, that sense of, you know, I'm sure Yair felt that he got this too, the whole thing, and when this election is over, we're coming after you. And, you know, Bethany Mandel got her gun before, and I'm sure I've had conversations in my household about getting a gun too.
Well, tell the Bethany Mandel story.
Okay, Bethany Mandel, you know, although Yair was number two, the number one guy on that list was a former Breitbart guy. And there was, Ben Shapiro. For conservative Jewish writers, the attacks have been kind of laced with this sense of betrayal. And Ben Shapiro, who had been a Breitbart reporter or a Breitbart editor, had left. He was the vitriol that was thrown at the guy was just remarkable, and it was because it was like the apostate. He deserved everything and more. And Bethany Mandel, another conservative Jewish writer, never Trumper, was also attacked really brutally. And when they said they were going to come and get her and her young child, she went out and bought a gun and then wrote about going out and buying a gun. So, I mean, obviously, you don't want to be alarmist, although my mother is, you try to wait and see. But, I mean, the messages that I've gotten since the election have all been, now we're coming to get you. Well, we won. And I, if you think, that these people will be satisfied because of their electoral victories, I think you'll probably have another thing coming, because I think they're going to say, now we get to impose our will. We won, and that's the message that I could probably look on my Twitter feed and find right as we speak.
And so, Brittan, you're relatively new to ADL, and I don't want to put you in an uncomfortable position, but ADL has been outspoken about Trump-related issues, including Steve Bannon, who you could argue has a journalistic platform that he controls. Do you have a point of view about the implications of that going forward for what we're talking about?
I mean, not for ADL.
Okay.
I think that you should look at the situation holistically and focusing on one of the problems that I have found with the abuse that's going on Twitter is that it acts as a megaphone. You know, it's not just one person telling you you're horrible, you're bad, you're Jewish, and that means something wrong. It amplifies that 10, 20, 50, 100 fold. And based on the nature of the platform, it doesn't go away. And sometimes when people are harassed in that way, I believe that's what drives them off of the platform. And I think what affects journalists in particular. Because if you were to go to work every day and open your computer screen and see hundreds of people telling you how bad, stupid, and flawed you were, you wouldn't stay in that job very long. So I think putting somebody in a position like that sets a tone. And it is that tone that we see reflected again and again and again, which can be problematic.
We shouldn't spend too much time on the challenged business model of journalism, New York Times, Tablet, wherever, but it is important. Britain's last point about the challenges journalism and journalists already face are now intensified under this set of circumstances. Yair, do you have any point of view about what this means for journalism and journalists' ability to cover the government?
So I don't know if it's directly related to the sort of trolling and stuff that you see online. I think that we're going to wait and see if this Trump administration is going to be as transparent and as open as previous administrations, whether they will allow journalists to cover the president's movements, things like that. And also, I guess, whether or not certain signals, whether deliberately or not deliberately sent by the White House, will inflame some of these online trolls who will then go to the defense of the administration and attack journalists. who, say, Trump has expressed displeasure with on his Twitter feed. But I honestly couldn't say. And we will find out. And also, it also depends on what we all do here and what policymakers and what Twitter decide to do.
I mean, I'll let you in a little few company secrets of the New York Times. You might be surprised.
This is off the record, I guess.
No, it's on the record.
Yeah, it's
okay.
Not like it's being.
You might be surprised to know that 70% of New York Times articles are read on the phone. We actually don't write for the newspaper anymore. We write for your phone. And of that 70%, about 30% are referred from social. Twitter is actually a very small amount of that. Twitter is a strange melange. It's a conversation between journalists, between policymakers, and between these kind of trolls and activists. Most of our social coverage comes actually from Facebook. And Facebook, although it certainly has its darkness, doesn't have quite the darkness of Twitter, because obviously anybody who wants to follow me gets to follow me. Anyone who wants to friend me on Twitter, I mean on Facebook, I need to friend back. And I actually will go through, if somebody asks a friend request, I will go and find out who that person is. I'm not as profligate with my Facebook.
And then there's, of course, the question of anonymity, which is
yes,
important.
Right. You cannot, yes. I mean, there's this guy, I'm sure that Yair has run into him, Shlomo Schekelberg. Shlomo Schekelberg is one of these Twitter trolls, anti-Semitic Twitter trolls. He's always attacking me. And I will go, I mean, when he goes too far, I'll report him to Twitter. Twitter started this thing where it used to be that if you report somebody for abusive behavior, you could like refer one tweet, and now you can go and refer five tweets. And you go down Shlomo Schekelberg's feed, and you're just amazed the ugliness and vituperation of the guy. But anyway, you report your five feeds to Twitter from Shlomo Schekelberg, and zap, he's gone. And 30 seconds later, he's back with a different Twitter handle. And the amazing thing is, he's always George Soros in his picture. He's always Shlomo Schekelberg. It's just that at name changes every time. And so it's just like whack-a-mole, right? I think Twitter is trying to find a way to do it. But as long as you grant anonymity, which they don't, you're not supposed to do on Facebook, it's a little different. But anyway, back to how journalism works. I mean, the fact of the matter is that we used to think that, okay, the future of journalism is going to be the newyorktimes.com, where people would go onto our homepage and they would read it kind of like a newspaper. And we were wrong. And then we thought maybe the future of journalism would be an iPad or a tablet, and you would still look kind of like a newspaper. But we were wrong on that too. What the future of journalism is social media. Social media is the passing around of information from various places. Luckily, the New York Times is one of the most passed around pieces of information or suppliers of information, but we can't just say, turn off Twitter, turn off Facebook. This is our future. And so we can't, to find a way to use it constructively and not be bullied off it is actually an imperative for our business.
But this makes the challenge even harder for some people, and I'm hoping as an academic that it's not going to discourage journalists from practicing journalism. It's getting harder. The public distrusts us more than ever. At least survey research confirms that, I think. We've never been less trusted, and this doesn't make things any easier, does it, Yair?
No. And in general, the fact that there are so many independent news sources that people can't distinguish on Facebook, some of which can be completely fake. This is starting to get some coverage, but fake news has become a serious problem for people to distinguish even what actually just happened. And it can enable people to live not just in a cocoon of opinions that flatter their own assumptions, but in a world that flatters their own assumptions filled with facts that aren't true. And the truth is that we noticed it because it happened during Trump's election, but this has been happening in other countries as well. There's a far-left leader in Britain named Jeremy Corbyn, who heads the Labour Party, and there are websites like something called The Canary, which are basically propaganda outlets for him, which largely do similar things. They report conspiracies and stuff that isn't true, but have captured a certain amount of the electorate, which is keeping someone like this in power. Now, fortunately for Britain, the guy is very unpopular among the broader electorate, but among his party, he has it in a stranglehold. And it's something that, like, I think Facebook and a lot of these other outlets need to start taking seriously. And it's not really, forget like what's good for journalists or not, what's good for societies,
yeah.
Right? They have to be able to distinguish fact from fiction.
I saw this morning Senator Ben Sasse of Nebraska tweeted out something about that we have to go investigate all these paid protesters and who exactly is paying them and where, how is this organized? And then I realized what this was, this came from a news source on Facebook who interviewed a guy who was being, who said he was paid $3,500 to go protest against Trump. And then the Washington Post had an interview with the guy who wrote the article and said, I just totally made that up. I couldn't believe everyone's talking about it. I mean, this fake news thing is insidious, and it's getting more and more difficult to ascertain what is truth and what is fiction, especially if it's stroking your own ideology.
Well, Twitter and anti-Semitism certainly add to the level of problems. I'm going from here this afternoon to an emergency conference at the City University of New York Graduate School of Journalism called Journalism, Where We Went Wrong and What We Can Do About It. So the navel-gazing about our topic and this context is going to be around for some period of time. Thank you all. It's been a great panel. Thank you all.